Dinosaurs. These gigantic beasts have captured our imagination ever since the first fossils were found. Over 66 million years ago, they ruled the Earth, but a mass extinction event wiped them from the face of the planet. Until now. Welcome to Jurassic Park.
Huh. Oh, hey. I'm Jake, and I'm just on vacation with my dad and my friend Harris Heller at an amusement park with real, live dinosaurs. I decided to have a little alone time and take this guided tour by myself, but then the power went out and everything has gone wrong. I don't know where my dad and my friend are anymore, and I also... Did you hear that? Don't worry, I got these cool night vision goggles. Let's see what's out there. Huh. I didn't... see anything, but maybe I'll try with the flashlight, have some better luck. Oh! Okay, this is happening. Before I was being hunted by a prehistoric beast. I had two loves in my life, science and movies, so I decided to put myself in one of my favorite films, Jurassic Park, to find out if you could survive
the destructive bite force of a T-Rex, being hunted by a pteranodon. And inversely, could dinosaurs survive in our world today given the changes in the habitat and environment?
Could you survive Jurassic Park? I don't know how we survived that T-Rex attack, but we managed to get inside somewhere safe, so that's good. What is happening?
Someone sabotaged the park. All the dinosaurs are loose. There's a boat on the other side of the island that's leaving in the morning or something, and I guess we're gonna die if we don't get on it.
Where exactly is this boat? Well, that was some expedited plot and a conveniently located map. Thank you, I think I'm all caught up then.
Okay, cool, I'm gonna go to the boat.
Oh, Jello! Oh, yeah.
Clever girl.
Hi! Okay, I don't think the raptors saw us hide back here, so we should be safe. Okay, they did, but the good news is, they can't open doors. And they can't open doors, so I was very wrong.
You know what else is wrong?
Oh, hey, hi, Justine.
Hey, Jake, how's it going?
It's going very well, thank you.
So the raptor was actually portrayed kind of unrealistic because in real life, raptors are smaller, feathery, kind of turkey-like. They're not that intimidating at all.
Right, our understanding of dinosaurs has evolved drastically since Jurassic Park's release in 1993, in large part because of that film inspiring a lot of people to get into the study of paleontology.
Hey, cutie. Hi there.
Don't worry. I got this.
Are you sure you don't need a little help with this guy?
Eh.
All right.
Busy.
Good luck.
Hold on to your butts.
Those raptors are a great reminder that there is still so much to learn about dinosaurs. Like, did you know that some of the dinosaurs that populate this park actually lived hundreds of millions of years apart? For example... There is more time between a Stegosaurus and a T-Rex than us and a T-Rex.
Okay, time to go.
Also, similar to the raptor's portrayal, a T-Rex doesn't exactly look like its movie counterpart. It actually had colorful feathers and... All right, you know what? We're gonna stick with the movie T-Rex, because that thing is terrifying. Oh, no. Okay. Must go faster! And speaking of going faster, after the movie's release, it turned out that we learned something, and that is that a T-Rex really isn't that fast. It has a max speed of about 12 miles per hour, so... right, protected from the water, protected from that T-Rex. I think we're pretty good. Harris?
Oh, hi, Jake.
Dude! Are you okay, man? Get in the Jeep!
I had to pee, but also I wanted to get this souvenir for my wife. She's crazy into fossilized mosquitoes. It's really cute.
Cool. Actually, speaking of which, in the movie they extract the dinosaur DNA from the blood of mosquitoes encased in amber. Now, the biggest problem with that is something called half-life.
DNA's half-life is 521 years, meaning every 521 years, its nucleotide bonds are cut by half.
Because of that, it's only possible to recover useful DNA from the last 6.8 million years, putting us well short of the dinosaurs who lived 66 million years ago. So this, useless.
Yeah, Jake, that was for my wife.
Yeah, right, but we really have to get to the boat, Harris.
I hear you, but I gotta pee again, so I'll be right back.
No, dude. Harris, do not go pee in a Jurassic Park movie!
Jake, you wrote the script. I'm gonna be fine.
Also, you're 100% still wearing your shorts. I don't know how that works. Oh, Harris! Harris!
Wash it!
No! Harris, no! Oh, I really liked Harris. He has great content. But what would actually happen if a giant T-Rex were to eat your body? I just happen to have a machine to test just that. When it comes to being eaten by a T-Rex, there are two important factors at work, pressure and tension. Now, with a T-Rex with a 1.2 meter jaw equipped with 60 teeth, it had a bite force around 35,600 newtons. That is exerting pressure anywhere between 690 million to 2.75 billion pascals at the tip of each tooth. And to understand just how powerful that is, the amount of pressure needed to puncture concrete is 34.5 million pascals. Puncturing steel takes 345 million to 690 million pascals. Still less powerful than a T-Rex. Which begs the obvious question, what does it look like on a human? And also, how does tension factor in? Well, good news! We happen to have this machine here that is a replica of a T-Rex's jaw to find out. Let's do it. Utilizing recent research by paleontologists, our T-Rex stand-in is driven by a customized motor, generating roughly the same power as a T-Rex's jaw, allowing us to replicate the speed and force of a dino bite.
3, 2, 1, fire.
Scientists have recently discovered that the T-Rex crushed its prey with the teeth in the front of its mouth. Unlike modern carnivores. So when the teeth came together, they stretched their prey's bone, which places the bones under tension, weakening the internal structure of said bones and making them easier to snap from the jaw's pressure. Yeah, okay, so that's pretty not survivable. But using modern technology, is there a way you could survive that bite? Well, this Kevlar vest should withstand 3.45 billion pascals. That is almost 700 million more than exerted by a T-Rex's bite. So, you should be safe, because in theory, the vest would stop the teeth, which in turn would mitigate the tension on your bones. But would it mitigate the pressure exerted by the T-Rex's bite? In short, no. While the teeth couldn't fully puncture the Kevlar vest, that didn't stop the bones from snapping under the immense pressure. This was shot at 10,000 frames a second, meaning the skeleton was subjected to that nearly 2.75 billion pascals of pressure in only 40 milliseconds. Just for fun, what would it do to your head? That's no good. Okay, it is daylight. We have not much time to get to the boat, or else we're gonna end up like Harris. Come on. Oh. That is a big boy fence. Ooh, it's an electric fence. You know, in Jurassic Park, the character of Tim is blown off a fence that looks very much like this one when the electricity is turned back on. But as we learned in our Back to the Future episode, electricity is always looking for the quickest path to the ground. So in Tim's case, he'd be totally fine. That is, of course, unless his feet were on the ground and his hands were touching the wires, then he'd be electrocuted. Like this. I'm just joking with you. I can't die.
What are you doing?
Ooh. I was just doing a little movie science explainer.
Okay, well, I figured as much, but you're supposed to be on the boat, which is on the other side of the island. It's pretty unrealistic that you're gonna even make it back to the boat on time. I guess unless you can fly.
Oh, no. You know, Justine should be fine, I think. It's a common movie trope. You know, when a lead character's death is implied off screen, generally, they are still alive. She's dead. I mean, that's pretty obvious. But I do have a question. Could a pterosaur, that is a flying dinosaur, actually pick a human up and fly away with them?
That's a good question, Jake.
Hey, Dr. Beeb, what brings you here?
I work here. I'm a paleontologist. And I happen to be a specialist in pterosaurs. Pterosaurs didn't have talons like birds do. Some of them had sharp claws, but they could not grip anything with them. Their feet were more like that of a crocodile.
And like birds, these flying reptiles can only lift half their body weights, if that. So our movie pterosaurs could maybe fly off with a baby at best. But what about bigger pterosaurs? Could those fly off with you?
Oh, you mean the big four?
Cryodracon, Quetzalcoatlus, Hatzigopteryx, and Aramborgiania.
Although they were bigger, they're still not capable of carrying you off with their talons.
Well, Dr. Habib, life finds a way.
No.
Okay, well, good news is, since they can't lift us up, fly away with us, we're totally safe.
Well, even though they couldn't lift you off the ground and fly away with you, they could still horribly kill you.
What?
It was actually their wings that you had to watch out for. Specifically, what I like to call the pterosaur smash.
Pterosaur smash! According to research by paleontologists like Dr. Habib, cryodrakens walked with their wings, using some of the largest muscles ever to evolve on any animal. Pterosaurs would smash into you with a knuckle on their wing, basically a mid-wing fist. Kind of like this. Our fist is one-third the size of a pterosaur's knuckle, so we adjusted the amount of force needed proportionally to equal the scale of the pterosaurs, which gives us this.
Ooh.
The fist drove through the bones and deep into the chest cavity, only stopping at the spine. And that's just one pterosaur smash. Imagine this happening over and over and over again, which they were believed to do. You, would not be okay. Man, I'm back in the center of the park, which is nowhere near the boat, and that boat leaves right now. Yikes! You know, you might be thinking that standing still is the best chance of survival when facing a giant carnivorous dinosaur. But as it turns out, a lot of dinosaurs, for example the T-Rex, actually had really great vision, so standing still wouldn't really help you. But all that might be a moot point, because I wonder if when they created this park, they even considered if dinosaurs could survive in our current climate and with today's agriculture. Allow me to explain. Scientists consider the 165 million year run of dinosaurs the greatest ever for a dominant group in history. That is until their environment changed so rapidly they couldn't evolve fast enough to handle it. And in the 66 million years since they roamed the Earth, the ecosystem continued to evolve, while they didn't. So the question is, could these incredible beasts live in our environment? Current research says no. And that's partly thanks to a lack of appropriate food, as well as a lot of diseases that there is no immunity for. Oh, that is a huge pile of poop. Actually, I can show you what I'm talking about. Here we go. Ugh. Oh, that's the stuff. Ugh. This berry is from an angiosperm, aka a flowering plant. They make up 90% of the plants on Earth today, but didn't even exist in the Jurassic period, so there's no reason to think that they would be able to get nutrients from it, or that it would even be considered food by dinosaurs from that time.
And then there are the changes to atmosphere. Paleoclimatologists have modeled the ancient atmosphere to reveal that the air in the Cretaceous period had at least 26% oxygen in it, and maybe as much as 34%. Now, by comparison, the air we breathe has only 21%. But what does that mean? Well, for a dinosaur from the Cretaceous period, say a T-Rex, this represents a 23% decrease in atmospheric oxygen. Let me demonstrate how that affects the body. I'm going to run on this treadmill for 5 minutes with a level of oxygen I'm accustomed to. Then, after a 10-minute break to get back to my baseline, I will run again, but this time wearing an oxygen limiter, which will decrease my available oxygen by 23% to experience what it would be like for a Cretaceous dinosaur today. I forgot how monotonous running is, but I feel great. I feel alive. Call me Usain Bolt, because I am fast, you know?
This is gonna suck. Feels like a suffocating.
It was not fun at all. It was really hard to breathe. It felt like I was suffocating. I can't imagine a large dinosaur like a T-Rex or some weird hybrid dinosaur being able to maintain that kind of energy and speed with a 23% decrease of oxygen. It was terrible. So if this was the real world, we'd be safe, but it's not. So guess this is where my journey ends. And as always, sorry, this is a little embarrassing. Dad? Dad, where are you? We gotta get off the island.
I caught a ride home with the InGen folks last night, and I'm here having a cocktail. Cheers!
Okay, but why'd you run away?
I knew I had to get off the island, and you're such a Jurassic Park nerd, I figured you were gonna stick around and do one of those science videos.
Ouch, but I mean, you're not wrong. I was just hoping we'd be in this episode together,
but
like...
I promised the InGen guys that you'd make a video with them if they sent a helicopter to the island to rescue you.
Oh, well... First things, thank you, but also, you can't really promise that I'm gonna make videos for people.
Jeez, a lot of things... just shut up and get on a helicopter. We'll talk about it when you get home.
Yes, sir, I love... Dad, I love you. You got disconnected, I think. Well, that helicopter is very convenient, and as always, thanks for watching. On System. Oh no. Come get some. Let's make me hypothermic. Tear this body apart.
Oh, the need for speed.
I don't think you're gonna survive this one.